Yo. I'm up. Turn me up, Slim. Turn me up, Slim. Turn me up, Slim. Oh, you say, yo. Hey, turn me up, Slim. Turn me up, Slim. Turn me up, Slim. Oh, you say, yo. Turn me up, Slim. Turn me up, Slim. Turn me up, Slim. Oh, you say, yo. Hey, turn me up, Slim. Turn me up, Slim. You say, yo. You say, yo. I said, ain't no guy like the one I got. Matter of fact, ain't no other guy, period. Everything you've done for me, they can't be serious. How could I not believe that you will? Deal or not, I'ma still get these dreams to pop. And stay in trumpin' and time, that's a word that pops. I'm from the bad boy life, know that I won't stop. Till the Lord come and stop my heartbeat. Y'all can't believe the eyes that I beat. A soldier, take off the boots of my feet. God called to play, called to give and go. So I gave my problems to him, now I'm going to sleep like, oh. Y'all don't mind, you're gonna get yours, so I gotta get mine. Thanking the Lord, cause he kept my mind. Don't need no drugs, I can feel his love, yeah.
I get joy when I think about what he's done for me.
I get joy when I think about
what he's done for me.
I get joy when I think about
what he's done for me.
Oh, yeah.
What he's done, what he's done.
Can I speak, man? I said I still got homies that are twisting up their fingers. Praying for my brother, sometimes he's a heavy drinker. But who am I to judge? I used to reek of the reefer. But I had to change my life because I am my brother's keeper. Like, oh, if you don't know what I've been through, oh, don't you stop my praise, oh. And if he keeps going, man, if he keeps going, cause ain't nobody going home. One day they don't matter, oh. I don't care what they say, oh. Ain't nobody going home. I'ma play this song for the saints to get their praise on.
I get joy
on.
When I think, oh, yeah, about what he's done for me.
Oh, I get joy, no, when I think about
what he's done for me.
I get joy when I think about
what he's done for,
oh,
me,
yeah.
Good morning.
Yeah, good morning.
This is the Church Unplugged on ATL's Next 100, IBNXRadio.com. And yeah, glad to be here. Glad to be here this morning.
Yeah.
You're here with the pastor, Lester. And yeah, we got some things to talk about.
Yeah, hey, I told you I was going to slide in this morning like old Eddie Kane. You know, we're dealing with a little traffic out here. I know Donald Trump was here yesterday. He had traffic tied up.
He was here last night.
We got a few things in the city. But anyway, we here. We made it. I slid in like old Eddie Kane. If you know the heartbeats when he slid right into his position, right on stage, but we ready to go. You want to do a recap, L?
Last week, you know, we really got into the thick of things. And what we're spending a lot of time is talking about relationships and is talking about how what can I say? We follow a blueprint. We kind of outline. Well, last week was Armor Bearers versus Paul Bearers, and I was thinking the week prior to that.
Yeah,
but we're really just trying to lay out a blueprint, you know. So if it's not about, how can I say this? I feel like I'm stuck. I feel like I'm off.
So it's a blueprint, but the thing to it is, and here's a side to it.
It's not a finger in your face, Pat. You feel me? It's not a finger in your face.
Yeah.
But it is like a
kind of like, hey, come on.
Come on.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So, we can do better. We can be better.
So y'all get it. So in fact, doing better, here's the thing. So like you say, not a finger in your face, but a come on.
Right.
You know?
Right.
Yeah, there you go. So this is a come on, you know. We can do better. And here's the thing. And here's one reason why we say blueprint, but we're not, because we regular cats, man.
Right.
You know, this is Church Unplugged. We are open. We are just who we are. We're trying to take this veil off and remove this heavy traditional religious spirit.
Come on.
So we're facing it in honesty from the word, but in a way that hopefully it can translate to a better understanding for the right. people. So we're not judgmental. We're right. not, but we do have to stick to rule.
Come on.
Right?
Come
so,
on.
So that's why he said, not finger in your face, but God's word don't change. It's for all of us, and we have to digest it the way that we supposed to.
I had an interesting conversation. We may get into it. We may not. Cool. But folks can be funny with that term judgment and judgmental.
Yeah.
And, you know, we understand that there needs to be rules. There should be rules. Rules keep order. Rules keep everyone in line in this massive world of Man. Millions upon millions of
upon millions.
Right, of ideas and thoughts and this, that, and the other. Mm-hmm. Well, to keep everyone in line where we can at least get along with each other, let us all conform to a set of rules.
Yeah. Ain't that what we did with Romans? When we hit Romans.
Book of Romans, the entire book is to establish.
And it wasn't our rules, but it right. was rules that, you know, we can do when in terms of living a better lifestyle as a Christian.
But it's funny when you start talking about those rules and following those rules, mm-hmm. how individuals want to cast you into a sea
Man.
Of judgment. Or you judging. You no, it's not judging. Like that, I'm not even in the position to judge. Yeah. I don't have the authority.
Well, okay, let
to
me ask
judge.
You this. Let
Break
me ask
it
you
down.
This. If you say you follow the God that I follow, uh-huh. you know, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob.
Come
and
on. What,
and if that's your claim.
Come on.
And if I see you doing something particularly out of order.
All right.
That's going to cause a derogatory light on the God that we say that we follow, mm-hmm. do I not have a right to step to you and ask you?
Hey, man, iron sharpens iron. And
for real. So
I'm not even that sensitive. So I would want you. I would want you. Particularly if you're operating in the right spirit. I mean, you're just trying to help me out.
For real.
Trying to help me out.
There you go.
But like I said, this is really a different topic. And if I introduce it, now the show's going off.
But
so
I think it works. I'm thinking
might,
it works.
We might talk about it later. But hold on, Pastor. So just so what you were saying, recap. Hey, listen, guys, we're talking about relationships. Last week, we were talking about being the right kind of friend. You know, are you an armor bearer? Are you a pall bearer? It's heavy into relationships, guys. Our tone or our angle or our direction is heavy into relationships and making sure that we're doing our best to mm-hmm. seek and be the best examples that we can be in a very real context. So following in that line, we wanted to discuss this week, wow, you know, how to fix, how to repair, how to heal, right? Relationships. And that's pretty profound. Definitely worthwhile. Definitely worth talking yeah. about. But that's huge, man.
You know what? We are living in it's a big world.
Yes,
it's a lot of problems going on. And one thing that God put on my spirit this morning, when we talked about healing relationships, He said necessary relationships.
Come on,
so
come on.
There's a difference. So sometimes we are at odds with people, and it would be, we haven't identified sometimes if that is a necessary relationship. So you don't have to fix everything. Everything that you've done and every relationship that has been won or lost, sometimes we got to understand that, like we said last week, some things are seasonal. So now we walk away from certain things, but there's some necessary relationships that we do need to heal from.
Come on.
And we do need to restore. We do need to replace. And so we're not telling nobody to go out and try to fix everything that is broken. And there's another scripture that I want to that I'm going to find for you here in a minute. But one thing that God says, it says what God has, you know, endowed you with or given you, you know, there's no sorrow that comes behind it. So anything that God gives you, any relationship He puts you in, if there's no sorrow to it.
Okay.
It's going to have its divine purpose. The purpose for it is going to show up and be. And so understand every relationship or everything that you walked away from or every armor bearer, pall bearer, or we're going to say pall bearer because we're talking about healing. Armor bearers, we shouldn't have, we should be okay with. You know, in this present state. If you're an armor bearer, we should already be there. But I guess sometimes you do be at all, even in that situation. But there are some necessary relationships, especially when we say that we are Christian.
Okay.
You know, now if I tell you I'm Christian, But I ain't talked to my brother in 5 years, my biological brother, uh-huh. because I'm letting some alt or something that happened or whatever the case weigh that relationship, you know.
We talking about relationships.
Where am I showing? Where am I showing my faith? Where am I showing my strength in the God that I believe in? You know, we're talking about the God of second chances, right?
Come on.
Because I'm gonna tell you, we all needed it. We talking about the God of second chances. We talking about the God of that heals, the bridger of a gap, the mender of broken hearts, the securer of breaches. You know what I'm saying? This is who we talking about. So if we say that we Christian, we say that we are who we are, and we can't display the characteristics of forgiveness, the characteristics of repair, the characteristics of the very same second chances mm-hmm. that we ask God for, who are we really? I mean, does that say it?
Yeah, that says a lot. Specifically speaking, a couple of scriptures came to mind. I wrote down Galatians 5:14 talks about the entire law is summed up in a single command. We're talking about, you know, what God would have. These are the opinions of men mm-hmm. that you're hearing, but our opinions are our advice, if you will, our conversation
yeah.
is steered.
Yeah, from the word.
Okay. And so what's his intent? And if we fall out of, we have to first figure out what it is that he would have so that we recognize when we're out of line, when stuff isn't right. You have to first know, well, what is right? Because several of us have a misinterpretation of.
Absolutely.
Sometimes, you know, we think it's what feels right to us. But in fact, very quickly, Galatians 5:14 says, hey, the entire law is summed up in a single command, love your neighbor as yourself. Let's just throw out some simple context out there. Mm-hmm. Loving your neighbor as yourself is the command. Be eager to maintain the unity of the spirit in the bond of peace. So, be about unity, guys. Don't stir up a lot of mess, a lot of junk. So, and I know, well, there's so much that we can say.
Yeah.
Right. And then just kind of following in that as for Titus.
Before you get too far away from that one, man. That one, be eager. Read that one again.
Be eager to maintain the unity of the spirit in the bond of peace.
Okay. I mean, man, that's deep. And that
that's what you should be eager about.
Yeah. So some people, and so you know that you could do the wrong thing or the right thing the wrong way and still be wrong, right?
Oh yeah.
Sometimes we got to get away from looking to check somebody. Mm-hmm. We got to get away from looking to, you know, stir up the mix a
Come
little
on.
Bit, you know, because I think you said it last week. You said sometimes as that friend, we that ride or die. And once we get that phone call, man, we, you know, hype, ready mm-hmm. to come make that move. Whatever it is, you know, whatever characteristic you carry, you know.
Right, we want to show support. I got your back, I'm with you.
Yeah, but
come on.
Being eager for peace.
Come on.
Being eager to have that bond of peace, man. Mm-hmm. We have to get to a place where we grow to where we want to come and pacify a situation, better a situation, make it a little bit. You know,
I got you. And just as a response to that, right? It is so funny because, as you pointed out, as we were reading last week, you know what I'm saying? I know I took one to the jaw.
Yeah.
I know I took one, quite frankly, where he spoke about your friends who get angry, your friends who are quick to anger, your friends who are quick to, you know. And like I said, you think you're there showing support, and in fact, you're totally out of the will.
But here's the thing. Sometimes to the person that you're showing the support for, mm-hmm. that's what they wanted, that's what they needed, or that's what they used to.
Right.
How do we make that change? How do we turn that corner?
Titus here, and again, Titus 3 verse 10 reads, as for a person who stirs up division after warning him once, then twice, have nothing more to do with them. Now I'm gonna leave it there, Jack. I'm gonna leave it there. Now again, what we're trying to do here is just let's just get the conversation going.
Yeah.
Let's just set it up as far as hey, listen, we're in these relationships. Sometimes we end up chasing the wrong ones. We try to reconcile with with the wrong ones, and our heart is right, but our methods are off. So in all things, get understanding. We're just trying to lay out a simple premise that'll hopefully save a lot of people, a lot of stress, a lot of issues, a lot of fights, a lot of arguments, a lot of wasted time, okay, by just saying or by just showing what the word has to say about these things, about relationships. And then again, when they're broken, when they're hurting, when they need to be repaired, how do we identify those? Was this a seasonal relationship that served its purpose? And thank you, Lord, adios. Was this a relationship that, no, he would have me to stay in and to fix as an example, as a glorification of?
Yeah. Or was it one of them necessary relationships?
Or was it, yeah. Or am I tripping? Do I want it for the wrong reasons? Am I fighting to keep it for the wrong reasons?
Yeah. So I'm going to tell you, when it comes to healing of that sort, man, this is full. So y'all got to be with us. Stay tuned. Stay with us. Keep watching us, because we are going to uncover some of these truths. Mm-hmm. We're going to uncover. And it's not just opinion. You know, we may bring it across as such, but this is word. So you right here on Church Unplugged, we get ready for this. Go and pay a few bills here, but be right back with us here in just a moment. So this is the pastor. This is Lester. This is healing. Church Unplugged.
So I dropped the label, get it straight from the streaming, so I cut the cable. There's a difference between a legend and a fable. They didn't have enough seats, so we built another table, yeah. Look, I don't want the beef and I don't want the bacon, yeah. I told all my haters, assalamu alaikum, yeah. I threw shots at Satan, they were faith and patience, yeah. God threw shots at Satan, he won't make it. I'm happiest when listening to sad songs. Had a lot of good friends give me bad thoughts. Pulled in different directions like I am cat dog. Finally called the label and told them this is my last song. A lot of people don't like the way that I rap, dog. You know your choir director listen to Mask Off. I've been captured by beauty, I hope it catch on. I'm just doing my duty, I hope you find yours. I told me he got me, no doubt like I'm Gwen Stefani. Been so blue like Sonic, I don't wanna be more cool than honest. I got hooked like Phonics, on follows and likes and comments. I'd rather have applause and closing on $1 million. But I'm growing, though, not worry about so-and-so. On my way up, like I was headed up to Roanoke. Only master that I have was risen, then ascended. That's why I got my masters back, I do this independently. I don't need a label, so I drop the label. Get it straight from the streaming, so I cut the cable. There's a difference between a legend and a fable. They didn't have enough seats, so we built another table, yeah. Look, I don't want the beef and I don't want the bacon, yeah. I told all my haters, assalamu alaikum, yeah. I threw shots at Satan, they were faith and patience, yeah. I threw shots at Satan, he won't make it.
More wins than a LeBron team. We got more V's than a garage scene. Deal card, he wasn't capping. God did it, the deal's off, I peeled off. Reason for speed and the real caught it like Randy. It's the season, they wanna be down like Brandy. The victory mine, they say that history mine. And not to mention, I get different with time. Bumping P, I'm thinking G, it go insane. You can't beef with me, my brothers ain't got it made. I can't beef with you, my father gonna be on my case. I know a thing or two about getting through the game. I struggled, I know the difference from rapping. Real wins, the real win in the long run. Yeah, it take a minute but feel different. Or get a deal and deal with it.
Yeah, P. I don't need the label, so I drop the label. Get it straight from the streaming, so I cut the cable.
There's
a difference between the legend and the fable. They didn't
we back, this is Pastor and Lester. We're talking about healing. Man, I like what we were just chopping it up about, L. Why don't you dive? I think that's some good meat for the listeners to hear, man. I think that makes a lot of sense to what we're dealing with. I want you to hit that. Hit a couple pieces on that.
Just as a quick overview of what we were talking about here, it's really just trying to set up a very simple format. Let's not overcomplicate it. Let's keep it real simple. As far as the relationships that God, our Lord and Savior, would like for us to have within the body.
Yeah.
Okay? Don't overthink it. Don't get too super scriptural. Pretty lame in terms, if you will, ways of placing Ephesians 4, verse 3. Be eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. Y'all be peaceful. We don't have to run around here, you know, causing disruption or even in this crazy world we're in, trying to match crazy for crazy. We can be strong. We can have a quiet strength. And we can be providers of, promoters of peace. Secondly, just in line with that, as the pastor and I were talking, I just kind of wanted to make sure we understood the simpleness of the law. The entire law, according to Galatians 5:14, the entire law is summed up in a single command: love your neighbor as yourself. Let's just first get back. This is important, guys. Mm-hmm. We seem to be in a generation where we're self-absorbed. It's about ourselves, us, and a very unique, and how through division, through differences, through, you know, exploiting or capitalizing again, capitalizing on was different between us. That seems to be how we identify. Mm-hmm. That seems to be how we've now chosen to show how we're strong, stronger, better.
And I don't know why that is, man.
It's wild.
It's a lot of, and you know, this is some stuff that we can't even blame on social media. Mm-mm. You know, because, you know, nowadays people blame social media for everything. But over the years, we have grown to adopt that attitude. I don't know what it is to where trying to show yourself, you know, more vicious or more whatever than the other. It's almost like in a fight, you know, like sometimes, you know, you get ready to battle. Mm-hmm. Some people come to the table. Now, they can't scratch a fly, but they bring that energy, like, hey, come on,
That's all that.
And it's a hype in the beginning to try to push away some others when we are, and I'm going to say it like this. I think we have a misunderstanding of what strength is. Okay. Sometimes we don't realize that the strength comes from being more of a peacemaker, backing away, being more of a voice of reason or whatever, as opposed to trying to show yourself stronger, bigger, fiercer. And I think that's what's happening. I think that's the attitude that we've learned to adopt.
Okay.
This big, fierce attitude. And not understanding that it takes more strength in some areas to stand down and keep peace and be a better voice of reason.
I'll say this, just again, wrapping up what was previously discussed before the break. Titus 3:10 clearly tells us, as for a person who stirs up division, after warning him once, then twice, have nothing more to do with him. So if you didn't think he was serious about his instructions, about his command, about his intent, keep it up.
Keep it going.
Keep going. Keep stirring up nonsense. You're hearing the warnings. You're not heeding them. You heard them. You're not heeding them. And our directive is to, have nothing more to do with that joker.
Man, I'm going to tell you something. I came across a couple of them. I'm going to catch this. I'm going to catch these scriptures because this actually is creating a little bit of a turn, because you're right. Anytime we start talking about healing in certain ways, man, healing is so involved and it's so much, and there's so many different levels of healing that we need. But man, right on what you just said, I was reading this passage the other day, and the Bible says the person that is causing all the indifference and all the pain and all the structured garbage that happens between relationships,
come on,
said do away with them, put them out. He said when you put that out, in fact, it's in Proverbs, I can see it right now, when you put that out, that tend to fix a lot of the dissensions through different situations. So again, understanding what necessary individual, what necessary relationship there is that we have to heal from, man, we got to start. You said it the other week again. when you look in that mirror, what do we see? You know, when we look in the mirror, what do we see? I mean, one, identify first. Are we that person? But two, we got to think bigger, especially when it comes to the faith, and especially when it comes to, like you said, we all just need to get along.
Right.
Whole Spirit.
Right. Rodney King in this piece.
Can we all just get along? And when we
But we know it's not that easy.
It's not. But when we find, sometimes you got to look hard. It might be the very person that you love the most that you got to be honest with.
I'm going to introduce something. Mm-hmm. And I say introduce it. We all know it. Don't always like to hear it. But if we're talking about conflict resolution, if we're talking about fixing broken relationships, if we're talking about just walking better amongst our brethren, our fellow brethren, the key to all of that, mm-hmm. right, is us, is ourselves, the individual. And in as much as, this is going to get deep. And this is not about,
come on.
This is what I'm going to say.
Get your life vest.
Okay. When the problems that you have, okay, you have to ask yourself, what role do you play? Mm-hmm. You have to hold yourself accountable. It's so easy to blame and point the finger
yeah.
as to why you're bothered, why you have that offense, mm-hmm. what they should have, would have, could have, shouldn't have done. Okay, cool. We get that. Mm-hmm. But have you checked yourself? And I have found, this is nothing that I'm telling you that I heard, or maybe I did hear it and then listened and learned from it, and now I know it to be true. But I'm telling you what I know to be true. Guys, gals, sisters, brothers, we got to check ourselves. And in checking ourselves, we have to hold ourselves accountable mm-hmm. and ask ourselves, are we really who we're supposed to be with God? Yeah. Do we really have that relationship? See, a lot of reasons why we find ourselves out or in places of that we shouldn't be is because we ourselves mm-hmm. are not where we should be in relationship with. So I can't expect the blessings. Mm-hmm. I can't expect certain things mm-hmm. if I'm not walking a certain way, if I'm not relating a certain way mm-hmm. with God.
Well, man, I'm going to tell you, that's solid and that's deep. And that's the first part. It's just like even becoming saved. But you can't become saved before you first realize that you are the sinner yourself. Mm-hmm. You know, and we have to look in within ourselves. And this is all about the relationship. This is all about understanding how to heal. Actually, I want to make sure that you wrapped up with that because what we got sitting
got
here
it.
In Matthew, my man, there's something. And I want if Matthew, 18th chapter, 15th verse. And when you really look at some of this, that's sitting here in the Word, and it's funny. And this is a little sidebar, but you know how people are trying to chase down and say, you know, that this is the man's religion or this is whatever. And they, you know, and they've been, the devil's got people fooled. But when you look at how these writings have affected life between then and now, and when we read it, it's still so up to date. Looking at this one in 15, it says, moreover, if your brother sins against you, now everybody needs to hear this, mm-hmm. hear it deep. If your brother sins against you, go tell him his faults between you and him alone. So that's the first part. So you see that?
Yep.
Between you and him alone. Mm-hmm. He didn't say write a dissertation on Facebook.
Come on.
About the offense.
Come on.
He didn't say go tell everybody.
Come on.
He didn't say go, you know, have a what they had the little parties now. It's always a party for something, to get something off somebody's chest, to hang out with your home. The females do it more than dudes do. They get together and they get their drink on or whatever they got to do, uh-huh. and they talk about whatever that situation is. And really what ends up happening is they slaying somebody.
Okay.
Like it ain't what nobody's business. But it says, first part of it says, go to them and tell them about their faults, but just between you and them. You know, we got to have it to put in our business out in the streets. Mm-hmm. And this is talking about Armie Bear, Paul Bear, the whole nine, ill and evil relationships. We got a problem with putting the business out in the street first. Mm-hmm. And then all this other collateral damage that's caused by that, we wonder why we can't get the root of an issue, because we were out of order when we shouted it all out. We was out of order when we went and couched it, because we know our homeboys, our homegirls, is going to be like, what? They did what? What you mean? Yeah. And not knowing that really all we are doing is taking our offense, mm-hmm. we're putting it in everybody else.
Come on, you tell them. Come on.
And then now, between you and that person, y'all might have enough resiliency to get past it, but then now you done build a cloud around you, though. Mm-hmm. You done build a cloud around the other person. You done build a cloud around yourself, because at the end of the day, after you done that, then you go back and y'all cool again, people going to be looking at you like you a fool, because all the stuff that you done said at the party, mm-hmm. about all the stuff that you done put out there. So, I mean, y'all, this is some honest stuff. I mean, I'm speaking about it, but it's just honest stuff. And that I read that exactly right out of the Word. If you have a problem with your brother, and your brother sins against you, go to him, and first, between you and him. Mm-hmm. And then it says, if he hears you, you have ganged your brother. If he hears you. Say, but if he will not hear you, then you take it to one or two or more, that by the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established. So, again, sometime, and when he say two or more, that ain't Facebook. And when he say two or more, that's two or more that's within that circle. You touched on it a minute ago. Mm-hmm. We're Christians. Mm-hmm. You know, the Bible says to walk not in the counsel of the ungodly. So that means if we are dealing with some issues that we really have to repair, and we're dealing with a necessary relationship that right. has to be there, right. sometimes we do have to open that up if we can't get it together.
So to follow those directions.
Yeah.
With the intention. I'm not to go get a couple of my homeboys who are going to come in an intimidating manner.
Yeah, and pipe and, up.
Right, but and in front and say, see, God told me to get two or three of the homies.
Yeah, nah.
To tell you that ain't how wrong you are.
That ain't how we do it.
I need to go get some of these folks who I know are slanderers or who I know are, what do they call them, bloggers or whatever,
yeah.
to put it out. No, we're talking about intentionality.
Yeah.
You find good folks. You find healthy. You find fellow Christians, fellow folks who love, who care, and for about the peaceful reconciliation.
Yes.
To bear witness.
We got to stop.
Come on.
You know, putting it out there and just getting our feelings massaged. Because that's what a lot of people do. They could be wrong. They could be right. But they want to get their feelings massaged.
That's
by
right,
their
that ego.
You know, they want to get their ego, whatever. And a lot of times it's more so even if they're wrong.
Come on.
You know, you can't be in the beauty shop telling all your business.
Come on.
You can't be in the barber shop running your homegirl down. But then, you know, you're coming back behind closed doors and it's different. We got to approach that differently, man. I call it couching. You can't keep couching situations when there's a true need for reparation. You understand what I'm saying? So tell the story for what it is, if you're going to come to your witnesses. Tell both sides. Now, this is helping somebody. This is helping marriages. This is helping
it's helping a lot of folks.
Yeah, just regular standards. Don't go telling just a side that this is going to get you some cheerleaders. Tell it all, because sometimes you need to tell the situation and tell a part that you did so your armor bearer can be like, nah, my man, I think you did that wrong. And you might need to go and apologize to your wife or to your girlfriend or to your mama or to somebody. You might need to go do that. Mm-hmm. But that's not what we do. And that's the hard part of trying to really open up these doors for true healing.
That's right.
See, you can't get true healing if you're building it on a foundation of fraud. And I'm going to say fraud because that's what it is. When we go and we tell a story, we go and we tell our side. We don't tell the clear side where the infraction might lie. So then sometimes you may have to do exactly what they say. Go get a couple good people that can sit there and hear y'all out. You know, we had Dr. Rashonda Booker on, and she said she had to go to a good therapist. Sometimes you may need to do that if it's a necessary relationship. If it's your husband, your wife, your brother, your sister, and y'all dealing with something, man, sometimes we got to open up that door and get off of ego, get off of the power trip, get off of whatever it is that we think, and we need to go to that person. We need to redevelop what that is. We're going to get deeper in this because it goes deeper. Mm-hmm. We're going to get deeper. We're going to open up phone lines. We're going to do all of that, see what other people's perspective on it is. But, man, that word right there, it's hard. Again, it says, and if he refuses to heal them, hear them, then you tell it to the church. So we're getting deeper, we're getting bigger. But again, notice how we're getting bigger after, you know, the honest efforts of trying to build it. We didn't come.
Once again, hold on, bro. Just so we're going to tell the whole truth. So if he refuses to listen to him, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen to the church, then let him be to you as a Gentile.
Get him out of it.
A tax collector.
Hey, this is word. We read
hey,
word.
Man, it is what it is. Read it for yourself. You don't believe me? Read it for yourself.
Read it for yourself. Study and show thyself.
We're just speaking upon relationships and what they should look like. And when they're not looking like that, how to wipe that smudge out of our eye, how to clean our lenses off, how to get things right. Okay, that's all we're talking about, how to get things right. And like you mentioned, it's going to, and as I alluded to earlier, it's going to require a lot of introspect, a lot of sacrifice, a lot of humility.
That's it. So real quick, let's just read the steps real fast. And this is just a step to healing. We got a minute before we go to this next break, but this mm-hmm. is step to healing. So the first one is have a private conversation. Humbly confront the person that you're dealing with. If that does not work, then the second step is the offended party should take along one or two witnesses.
Come on.
So that's the second step. Third step, if that step fails, then the offended party should bring the conflict before. We're just trying to help you out. Bring the conflict before a greater authority or the church or whatever it may be.
A greater body of caring people.
Caring people. And then if the offender is still unrepentant, then the church should reject that person's company. And exclude him or her from the fellowship. And that's only because by this point, we know somebody mad because they just want to be mad.
All right. We know
somebody's hurt because they just want to be hurt.
All right. We know
somebody is in a state of unforgiveness because mm-hmm. they just want to be in a state of unforgiveness.
Come on.
At this point. So like Sister Kim said last week, mm-hmm. sometimes you just got to wipe your hands of it.
All right.
And call yourself clean.
All right.
We got this break coming up. This is Church Unplugged. We'll get a little bit deeper in this, y'all. And then we're going to take on some phone conversations after this break. We have the sports shorts. After that, but we're going to get it. So, Church Unplugged, Pastor and Lester, get ready for these phone calls, y'all, and we're going to dive back into this healing.
Say, I think it's time to do it again. Gorilla Faith. I'm
my chest as I was making the sound. Gorilla Fate. Yeah, boy, I'm a King Kong. I sing song, I win so. 50,000, I play them whole. With the power of the Holy Ghost. Increase the faith, my only goal. I got Gorilla Fate. I got Gorilla Fate. I got Gorilla Fate. I got Gorilla Fate. I got Gorilla Fate.
I'm having faith for real. I'm having faith. Got a meal on my plate for real. So I said my grace. Cause I know the enemy working. So I gotta pray. I need a flavor pack. I gotta get thanked. Gotta get thanked to the Most High. I'm going to heaven when I die. Got an angel with me, we gon' pop out. Holy Ghost flow, what you talking about? Shout out to Angela Rob. She a big daughter, my mama. Just wanna tell her I love her.
Welcome back, welcome back. Hey, this is the Church Unplugged, okay? And what we're trying to do here, what our mission here is really to take the Word of God for what it's worth, okay? I mean, and what I mean by that is not an interpretation, not an opinion, but we're reading from it.
Mm-hmm.
We're referencing scriptures. And to really break it down in such a way, you hear me say layman's terms,
mm-hmm.
to break it down in such a way where it can be understood, where it can be clearly understood. Still some room for interpretation, I get that. And feel free mm-hmm. to call in if you have a different take or would like to contribute, add something. We're all for it.
Mm-hmm.
But guys, in trying to make it simple, I just hope that the structure and the truth is not omitted, forgotten, or mm-hmm. or downplayed. No, the word is the word.
Mm-hmm.
For real. And yeah, if there's a way, you know, we can maybe take out a few thieves and thous and
mm-hmm.
and what was the word? What was the word?
Couple
weeks ago.
Contrary wise.
Contrary wise, yeah. Yeah, you know,
contrary wise.
If we could take out some of those 4, 5, 6 syllable
yeah.
joints. And make it easier or make it clearer, then hey, that's what it's yeah. all about. But make no mistake about it. Hear it for what it is. Guys, we're talking about the importance, right? Yeah. We spoke about the roles that we play in relationships. Now we're talking about the importance, in God's eyes, of relationships.
Yeah.
Healthy relationships.
Necessary relationships. And I'm going to tell you, if you don't know what that is, maybe it's time to pray about it a little bit. And what we're doing, like you said, we scratching the surface
right,
of it.
Right.
This is really just scratching the surface. We haven't hit these deep, heavy, weighted, but let me tell you something. That healing still starts right here.
Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of those healings and a lot of those offenses that have taken place still are foundational through relationship. Because the thing is, if you didn't love somebody or somebody wasn't supposed to be in that position of love and that position of trust, and, you know, it would be hard for them to really, well, I would hope so, that it would be hard for them to really get into your heart, to get inside deep enough to hold you at bay from a lot of things. And when I say hold you at bay, you know, there's blessings, there's things that we need in our life, and sometimes we are holding certain things up in our own life because we are still holding aughts against one another. We are holding up, for real, we're endowing.
Keep talking. An element, the truth.
A curse against some, you know, ourselves in a lot of ways because we are not letting go of some things we need to let go. And after the word says what it says about there. It says this. It says, and this is in 18. It says, "Assuredly, I say to you, that whatsoever you bind on earth will be bound on heaven, and whatsoever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." And that says exactly what I say. Don't have some issue that you got so heavy and so ran down here that it affects your position in heaven, that it affects your position with God, that it affects your position. But here's the strength. The strength in unity is where we come together and we agree upon a thing here. Man, God is looking upon that. Mm-hmm. He's tying that. You know, whatever we bind in earth, you know, whatever we loose on earth. He said, even one can put 1,000 to flight, but 2, 10,000. Look at the strength that we have when we unify. And we got to understand and identify that a lot of times that you are in failed relationships, whether it be marital, best friends, partners, business partners, things like that, is because there's a seed that's trying to be sown in that to devour what that potential is in that relationship. Sometimes you in the, especially when it comes to husband and wife and things like that, you met that person, y'all fell in love, and y'all know that together, y'all got the ingredients to plow the field and be so tough, be a power couple, if you will, whether it be business, in the church, in the community. But it's the devil's job to sow dissension in that and to show the sow discord in that to where you lose sight of what your initial focus was. You lose sight of what your initial blessing was, your initial calling, your initial whatever it may be. And that is a whole design. The Bible says that the devil encamps himself about the saints, walking to and fro as a roaring lion, seeking who he can devour. And he said he come to steal, kill, and destroy. And what you got to understand is he wants your peace. If he could take your peace, if he could take that serene ability for you to be like God and be creative in your mentality, creative in your nature, if he could take that away from you, then that's how he destroys your future before you can even establish it. So it's kind of deep.
Well, yeah, that's definitely deep. And again, what you said prior as far as the relationship aspect and the impact when you lose sight of and how all manner of relationship, with marriage, co-worker, working relationship.
Kids, man.
Parent-child relationships. That's deep. I don't know. Maybe it's because of some of that I've experienced it, but when you know how real it is, I can't help but sit here and hope that whoever's listening is getting it.
Yeah.
Is getting it for you know how it's intended.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you one thing, and I hope so, it's just the same. And I don't want to never dumb down a person's situation of what they're going through and what they're dealing with. Mm-hmm. But kind of what we spoke about a little bit earlier, sometimes we got some people that go through a weight and a heaviness that, you know, to some of us might think to be insurmountable. You know, I went through one myself, but losing my son. But I've watched over the years, and I don't know why, and you know, the Bible says that all things will work together for the good of those that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. So even when I lost my child, and as much as it hurt, I remember watching my mother when we lost my sister years ago. In fact, I want to say happy birthday, first of all, Mom, to my mother. It was her birthday yesterday, you know, and we enjoyed ourselves. We had a good time. But one thing that was unbelievable for me is when we lost my sister, we lost my sister on my mother's birthday. So that means every year, man, it's almost like a bittersweet type celebration that we all kind of endure a little bit. Mm-hmm. But the thing to it is we choose life. You know, we don't choose to get in the circle and cry, and we don't choose to whatever else. You know, we still have to be here. We still have to move through life. So we have to learn how to get beyond and surpass that weight and move forward, man. I mean, and sometimes, and I'm speaking this for a reason, because some of the things that we go through that we allow to create such an alt and such a difference between us are so light in comparison to some other people and their problems. I mean, look at Tennessee. you know, nighttime.
Yeah, we had a tornado.
A nocturnal tornado.
Come on.
Which is a whole lot worse. Swoops in the middle of the night when you ain't heard the sirens, you ain't got the TV on to get the warning, you ain't whatever. A nocturnal tornado.
That's right.
Came through and so we got people that's people still missing. Mm-hmm. So if I'm fighting with you about something that you said or somebody else said or somebody in between us said or whatever the case, man, I can look at some other scenarios that people are dealing with and be like, man, my stuff just ain't that big.
Come on.
Enough for me to be, you know, we need to be out here praying and building up a bridge for some other people that done lost some lives and that you know, are worried about some bigger things tomorrow.
That's right.
You know, kids walked out of their basement to no roof and no foundation. You know, things like that. So mm-hmm. I'm saying that to say, not to minimize, because to everybody they feel something a little bit different. But if you can just empathize for a moment, sometime what your fellow man is going through.
That's right.
And sometime what your fellow man is dealing with, you know.
Helps you put it in, put what you're going through in a proper
perspective.
Context. Yeah. No doubt.
So no like doubt. I say, and again, we're not touching the surface on healing, man, but we just trying to give some little nuggets to get the healing started.
Right.
To get the process underway.
If nothing else, to point out the reason why.
Yeah.
Because sometimes we don't do things because we feel we can do without them.
Yeah.
Sometimes we don't bother reconciling, one, because we don't want to truly get into what's wrong with us.
Yeah.
First. And then two, we could do without them.
Yeah.
We could do without them. It's... Anyway, I do want to just send out a prayer and support and whatever peace and strength that I'm able to at this time encourage others to provide for those families. Just that would be just what, north of us?
Yeah,
just up north. There in Tennessee.
Tornado that stretched 57 plus miles.
Yeah, and bodies are still turning up. Some still haven't been found. Truck stops. Truckers, be safe out there. Truck stops were destroyed.
Yeah,
like you said, in the blink of an eye. Yeah, that's true. That's true. One thing that I wanted to point out is just the significance in how being stubborn, mm-hmm. having a hard head, mm-hmm. letting your ego get in the way, mm-hmm. and really not working on exercising forgiveness, working on exercising repairing certain relationships. Again, God takes it seriously. It matters to him so much so that Matthew chapter 5, verses 23 and 24. And just to give a little context, much like the tithe, your offering, the gift that you used to bring down or that you would bring to the altar, it was a matter of, I don't know, Pastor, I'm going to say respect, but it was a gift that was given to the Lord, and it was almost to ensure your good standing with or blessings, mm-hmm. or things of that nature. It was your sacrifice. Mm-hmm. And that scripture that I just spoke of clearly says this. So if you are offering your gift at the altar and there, remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother and mm-hmm. then come and offer your gift. Now, I read that and sounded kind of cold,
man,
but the point of it is even in the gifts that you lay down before the altar with the intention of being a blessing and showing how much you care and love for,
mm-hmm.
it's not even respected or received. God still says, hey, you go fix what's wrong and then come back. You go fix what's wrong before you bring me anything.
But watch this. I'm going to tell you that scripture also interprets those in the church community that want to go shout every week and you ain't cleaned up some things
mm-hmm.
and ain't cleaned up some of these relationships. But you in church passing out and falling out and I should have bought a Hyundai and all, you know, Think that you are preserved mm-hmm. and righteous, but you still got these alts. That's what he said. Clean that up, then come to me. But I do think we got a caller. We got a caller online. Hello? Hello?
Yes.
Hey, how are you?
Yes.
That sound like Mama.
Yeah, this is Mama.
Hi, Mom. Hey, we love you. Happy birthday.
Thank you. Thank you.
Happy, happy birthday, Big Mama.
We hear you, Mom.
I'm just calling in about healing.
Yes, ma'am.
About healing.
We hear you. Go ahead.
Healing about my birthday, and I thank my son, Ronell, the pastor. He took me out to dinner. It was really good. And it kept my mind off of my daughter being killed on my birthday. But going through that with my daughter being killed on my birthday, I had other ones that also passed away. My stepson was killed in a car accident with about five or six other children on the highway. And then I had another son that was drive-by shooting, and he got killed. We was all in the house, my mom, me, and my granddaughter. And then my granddaughter passed away, 26, with heart failure. And then Ronell's son, my grandson, passed away. And so I'm calling about healing because for the simple reason of years back, my father had told me before he passed that it was something that was going to happen, and I needed to start praying so I would be strong for it. And I didn't know what it was. And then all of a sudden, all this started happening, one behind the other, and everything. And it just seemed like it was my little family that it was happening to, nobody else.
Yes,
and I didn't understand, but I didn't question God. I just prayed. And he gave me strength. So I came to the conclusion that sometimes God does things so we can help someone else.
Yes, ma'am.
And by prayer.
That's right.
And all that, that's what kept me going. And then the good thing about that is I know where they are. They're in heaven.
Yes, ma'am.
And that gives me comfort. And God will give you comfort when something happens like that.
Yes,
ma'am. He'll give you strength to go on. And I can't say that we're not human and we do feel it. But then when, with God's comfort and his love to wrap his arms around us and hold us and let us know that it's going to be all right and that we can help someone else that's going through this, because it was a lot on me. But when all this happened, I'm, instead of the people rounding around me, I'm trying to help them through all of this. Even when I found out that they had passed and that she was gone, I still was trying to help someone else.
Yes, ma'am.
So I'm just saying that if we put our trust directly and strictly in God, he will help us and give us comfort to go on. We
yes,
can
ma'am.
Make it.
Yes, ma'am.
But I was telling one of my sons yesterday that he called, and he was the one that told me that she had passed because he was there. And that he was emotional and he didn't think he could make it and yesterday and all that. But I told him, you can make it. You got God in your life and you ask God to help you. You can make it. You can be an example to somebody else.
Absolutely.
Because we're here for a purpose and a reason.
Yes, ma'am.
And he got special chosen ones that he, things do happen, but we can be an example to help somebody else. So what I'm saying today is that God, he's a comforter, and he can help us through anything that we go through. And then we'll have a testimony where we can help someone else. And I do have a testimony.
Yes, ma'am. Well, we appreciate that, Mom. And I watch you every day. And I have to say thank you. You are the epitome of strength, you and Dad, and y'all even prepared the way for me to deal with it when baby passed away, Ronell Jr. So
yeah.
And I don't know how y'all did it and how y'all do it even now, but I thank you for the strength.
Because we got God, and he, I trust in him for what I need.
Yes, ma'am.
And I trust in him, and as far as me, I'm going through things, but I'll never let nothing separate me from God.
Yes, ma'am, and that's the part.
And Jeff, and I'm going to keep going regardless, and because I'm not going to be lost, I'm going to heaven.
Yes,
and
ma'am.
If I can help somebody out here, well, I'm glad I do. I try to help them. I might not be out all the time, but you can best believe I'm on that phone. And yes, I'm ma'am. The type of person, I tell it like it is. See, when you tell it like it is, you don't have that many friends. But I do have a friend, and that's Jesus.
Yes, ma'am.
The best friend you could ever have.
Yes, ma'am. Well, Mom, we love you. We're going to go into a break. Okay. If you want to stay online, you can.
Thanks for calling in, ma'am.
Good. I really enjoy it.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. We love you.
Okay.
All right. Well, we're going to go ahead and jump on this break. We got a break coming, and then we'll recap what my mother said. Again, it was her birthday yesterday. Happy birthday, Mom. We love you. But let's go ahead and get this break, pay these bills, and we'll see you in just a moment.
All right.
Hey, man, I always wanted to do this one right here, man. Picture me rolling? Nah, picture me growing. Straight up. Kingdom Remix, KMF. Yo, Twan. Hey, Wu would've loved this one, bro. Yeah. Hey, y'all lies on me. God's eyes on me. The accuser of the brother switch sides on me. Trying to lie on me. Wanna ride on me. I'm a Bible told a baby. Hey, let me flip this Machiavelli, tell her picture me rolling. I'm a sanctified soldier, see the scriptures I'm holding. I'm a Texas Chicano, I preach the good news to the Cholos. I know that you say, cause I can see it in your ojos. Hey, they say Brenda got a baby, man, but Brenda wanna give up. Gotta get you through it, just get better, don't get bitter. And everywhere I go, they tell me, shorty wanna be a thug. That ain't really what shorty need, shorty need some Jesus. And mama checking in my room, but listen, I'm not there. Wednesday service, Bible study, yeah, I'm by my prayer. Used to think he was the realest, and everything he rapping like he was speaking my feelings. Ambitions of a rider and troublesome was my favorite, but I can even see that this message promoted Satan. Hey, I was bumping Machiavelli, I was running through the red lights. I hear driving daily in the nighttime with no headlights. 87 colors, we passing them state troopers. Hey, sirens all behind me, I keep turning up my music. Hey, years later, after years of answer prayer, I gave up gangsta music, cause my love for Christ is greater. Hey, I grew up bumping pop, twin of Wu. Now I'm not bumping pop, cause some music. Y'all eyes on me, guys eyes on me. The accuser of the brother switch sides on me. Tryna lie on me, wanna ride on me. I'm a Bible told a baby, you can find it on me. We got four Christians, AKMF. We praying fast, screaming Jesus Christ every time we pass. Yo, hey, we were living in a hotel, we were bumping dear mama. I don't wanna see you hurting, let me wipe the tears, mama. Pick my way to win my hate and pay it back when I'm bigger. Pick my way to win.
Yeah. Something you know we like to do here, the Church Unplugged. Just keeping everybody abreast of what's going on out here in these world of sports, these sports shorts. Listen, we got a big fight coming up tonight. Turn up a little bit now. I like that hustler. Yeah, thank you. So, little instrumental with Cassie.
My
just
man.
One of the joints, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Make you feel good. But anyway, hey, big night tonight, and we're going to get the spike.
Yeah.
But big night tonight, man, that UFC 248 with Israel Adesanya.
Man, my daddy know his name better than I do.
Hey, versus Yoel Romero. And, long story short, that young man there out of Nigeria.
Yeah,
he's a beast, man. You know, you talk about art in motion, you know? So he has the nickname Style Bender. He's coming in with a record of 18-0 in that 185-pound weight class. And let's see, he's 30? He's
about 30.
30-something?
30,
and the gentleman he's facing is a seasoned veteran. 13-4 is his record, but he's compact, man. He's built like one of them.
I ain't gonna take the Style Bender's glory, but I know the Style Bender been trying to call out Jones.
Come on, John Jones.
Yeah, and I don't. You know,
you better be careful what you wish for.
Yeah, I don't know if we're gonna give the Style Bender his glory today. Right. He's tough. He's a bad fighter.
I like him, man. I'm riding with him tonight.
Yeah,
I'm riding with him tonight.
You want to see some good going? That's gonna be jumping off on UFC. He's cold.
So I UFC.
Let me give him his fire, but I don't know about Jones Style Bender.
Yo, UFC pay per view. Check it out. And that's definitely worth watching, man. So what is that? Your local Buffalo Wild Wings.
wherever
you go, get it. If you're not going to order it, definitely see if you can get in front of a TV screen. All right, man. Second coming up is Spike Lee and what's going on in New York. So for those who weren't paying attention, we know Spike Lee, the movie director, the whole nine. Well, super huge Knicks fan. You know Spike, you know that.
28 years.
Front row. You know what I'm saying? Courtside seats.
Yeah.
Well, apparently, the owner, okay, of the Knicks or GM or whoever, Dolan.
Dolan, he going a different way. Dolan,
and bottom line, the door that my man has been coming in for, 28 years now?
Mm-hmm. 28.
What do we see? $290,000?
A year.
A year for these seats.
About 28 years.
For about 28 years.
Averaged about $10 million.
Was told. The entrance that he's been coming in, he can no longer come in anymore. It's designated an employee entrance. It was one where Spike, given his celebrity, was kind of in and out, could be discreet, has served well, no problems, no issues. Now, mind you, this same gentleman, Dolan, whatever his name is, he's the same one that had beef with Oakley. With Charles
had Oakley moved in 2017.
Just a few years ago.
Yeah.
And now he's taking issue. And again, we're talking about the door that hasn't been a problem. And anyway, wants him no longer to come in that way.
Want me to tell you my problem with that?
Break it down. What's your problem?
Now, he know this is Spike.
That's right.
He got his address.
Come on.
He got $288,000 on the check.
Come on.
He couldn't call him before and say, hey, my man, little Spike, we're going to have you come through another. He couldn't warn him.
I think he's saying he did, like, let him know.
He didn't. And that's why it was a confrontation and security, like, hey, like he was nobody. Look, you can't come through here. We need you to go. I mean, come on, man.
I don't know where the line of communication was broken between them, but I do know Spike has not only the support of Oakley, but he's also got my man Chris Paul.
Yeah.
Chris Paul, and I'm sure there'll be others soon to come. And for the record, let's be clear, if you can't respect the man, we know you respect the money. They're losing, y'all. Attendance has been record lows.
And Spike been there every losing game, every winning game.
Well, he's not, you know, he's boycotting.
Well, so he ain't going to be for the rest
Spike
of the year.
Now, he's boycotted for the rest of the year. With that boycott, his non-absence has kind of like been a protest. And again, post Spike's temporary departure. He's already said he's coming back next year. But since he's decided to leave and no longer attend, attendance has been down big time. Tickets.
Can I ask you a question?
Go ahead.
Have they asked Jack Nicklaus to come through a different door out in L.A.?
I mean, I don't know. I don't know. What are they doing to Drake up there in Toronto? I don't know. I don't know what's popping off in Houston and some of these other, you
spots
know.
Where you got the celebrities that ride out. That's you
and
part
you
of the
You
team.
Don't hear of any problems. Yeah. But again, you know, this is my man. This is this guy. What's it? I should look.
Not that I'm trying to make
Nolan
it about
Dolan.
The brother man, not the other man, but it sounds a little fishy to me.
Okay, and that's your opinion. But hey, man, that's where we're going with that's it with the quick picks and sports shorts for today, and really excited about getting back to what we were talking about. So we're out. We good? All right. So man, you guys had a chance to hear from Mama McNeil. The pastor's mama.
She Mama Polk now.
Oh, Mama B-O-L-K. Polk. Mama Polk. That's right. Betty L. Polk. I apologize.
Yeah, Mama Polk.
Mama Polk really called in and gave an incredible testimony. Now, I know that we are talking about mending and relationships. Well, healing definitely falls in that category. And relationships, as far as the source of pain, loss is definitely one. And loss of life, when you don't have that opportunity to apologize, when you don't have that opportunity to hug, when you don't have that opportunity to say, I love you. And in cases where the last words that were shared, the last dialogue, right, that went back and forth may not have been the most loving, right? May not have been the most kind. And Lord knows, specifically as it pertains to your family, bruh, it's my prayer and hope and belief that peace abounds, okay? Yeah. And I believe it does, as I know you and mom and dad and the fam. And
like she said, didn't she say stick to the word?
Right.
And that's the foundation.
So I'm confident that you guys have found that strength and that peace. And what an example to many of us who know you. That's an incredible way to show. Don't have to hear, don't have to preach, don't have to spend a whole lot just living in how your life reflects that strength. So I'm grateful. I appreciate it. But it all goes back to kind of what we're talking about. And no, we didn't speak specifically about loss per se, but in how to handle your relationships, right? My dad says he wants his flowers
now,
you know.
Hey, it's an old school song. Give me my flowers,
you know,
now while I can see them.
And I understand the point.
Yes.
When I'm gone, I'm gone.
That's it.
And let's be clear, ain't coming back. Don't want to come back. You feel me? I'm gone.
When you gone, you're not looking back here anyway. You know, it's over. So, and that's even with me. I want to see you want to love on me, man. Love me now. That's what we talk about, healing these relationships, these pallbearers, these armor bearers. You want to love on me? Love me now.
Right.
Yep.
Right.
Love me now.
And I just think that's very crucial. And we're talking about just those relationships. What a peace you can have in your heart when that time to say goodbye does come, and you have no regrets.
You know, well, I mean, I'm going to tell you, man, and one thing, and this actually kind of steers back right into what we were talking about, and it might bring a tough look to it, but I tell anybody, you know, if I got to position myself to live my life going forward without my son, man, it's some relationships that I got to be careful, because it's some stuff that I could cut off. You know, I can cut you off like a big dog nowadays because, again, when you have to make them levels of adjustment.
Come on.
You know, I got to live this life without my son, without my sister, without my... Man, some of this stuff and petty things that people be fighting over and bickering about and whatever the case, you know, I don't be having no room for it.
Come on.
You know what I'm saying? Not in my life. And I'm not saying because, look, I'm pretty sure I done been cut off, you know, and I'm being real. I done been cut off by some friends or by some folks, even myself. I mean, I whether I think it's justified or unjust, we all go through it, and I'm just being honest to it. I mean, like I say, we talked about it before. I remember when my son passed. I was wrapped up in grief. I didn't care nothing about some of the ways, and I was doing the best I can to be holy about it. You know what I'm saying? But there are some things that I just did not see.
Okay.
And that I might have been pushing some people into a place or whatever. And I don't think I was doing a lot of it, but, you know, when your eyes are back open to some of that. And so, like I say, I'm sure I'm a product of being cut off by some folks, but it is what it is, you know. But my whole thing is, if it's a necessary relationship, it'll find its way back, and it'll find its way to healing. So that's one thing that we got to understand. Whatever you're dealing with and whatever fence that you got between, but if it ain't necessary, man, fix it.
Well, bro, just know that you're not alone, bro. I've been cut off, I've been kicked out, and I'm cool with it. Let's be clear, you know what I'm saying? But no, I get it. And there's also, see, here you go, here you go, because now, right?
Yeah,
we are told to give certain things and certain people, we are told to give them free.
Hey, give them.
Let's be very clear now.
Give them free.
You just brought something up, made me think about it. There is another side to it. And don't get me wrong now. You know, God wants unity. God wants us to love each other, you know, as a brother And yeah, you know, this that is what God wants.
What did my man say? He got up and said, give us free.
Give us free.
Give us them free.
And so, simply that what that speaks to is
you're gonna have to let some stuff go.
You're gonna have to, hey, you hear me? Quick. Like it's hot. Like it hurts. You feel me?
It's some real stuff. Especially if you wanna escape, you know,
hey,
some of it.
You wanna keep your mind, keep your sanity, keep your freedom, keep from going to jail.
And give them free.
Give them free.
How many folks is in jail, man, because they didn't give somebody free that they should have? You understand what I'm saying? You sitting back and you should have gave them free, and now your freedom is gone.
Come on.
You feel me? So, I mean, it's a little fun to it, but it is what it is. I think we got a caller on the line.
Yeah, we do.
We got a caller.
Well, we'll wait. We'll wait until it gets through. But anyway, yeah, so that's a little side. That's a little opposite.
I'm a stodgy in a minute.
Hold on, Pat. We do have a call coming in right now. Let's see.
Caller, what's your name? Where you calling from?
Caller, can you hear us?
Yeah, I can hear y'all now.
Hey, how's it going? What's your name and where you calling from?
This is Zim McNeil. I'm calling from
Denver,
Colorado.
Zim, what's going on? That's my brother. That's my big brother.
Oh, this is a family show. Yeah. Oh, okay.
Hey,
okay,
there you go, big brother.
I'm calling to chime in on the pastor in the church. Unplugged. What's your name, my man? I never catch.
That's Lester.
Hey, I'm Lester.
Zim, you remember Lester. You probably just don't remember his face, but y'all was around each other.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. Y'all be too early for me on Saturday. When I get a day off, I'll be trying to be in the bed.
Hey, that's all right, bro. We appreciate you.
Grandbaby, so I was able to catch y'all this morning.
Yeah,
all right.
But, you know, I just want to call and chime in on your little relationship thing. You know, I'm really speaking on marriages and healing a relationship and marriage because I fell victim to a divorce of 28 years. And you start thinking about the pain and the hurt that you go through. And a lot of times, I like what my brother was saying about what bound on earth being bound in heaven and loosed on earth being loosed in heaven. One thing I had to do was get loosed from all of that pain here so that God can loose me in heaven so that I can find my new queen. You know what I'm saying? Because when you harbor all of that pain and hurt, you can't move on. You can't get past what was done to you. So you have blockage that kind of prevents you from being able to really open yourself to the next person. So it's just really quick and brief, you know, not a real long, drawn out thing, but I think I really just got to the point on that. You know, you got to let things go. You got to forgive not only the person that harmed you or did harm to you, but you also have to forgive yourself and just kind of release all of that just so that you can walk into the destiny that God has for you. That is, like he said earlier, it's been actually blocked because you can't get past the pain.
That's right.
If that makes any sense.
I do.
Oh, it makes a lot of sense.
That's all I had to say.
Yeah, well, man, we thank you for calling in, Zim. And yeah, I
appreciate the call, Zim.
And real quick, just so y'all know, my brother is an author himself. So he is an author of a book that you can get on Amazon right now. It's called "I'm Just Saying" by Elder Zim McNeil. He's a preacher himself. Yeah, and here's the thing: it might seem like you say it's not a family show, but
We went through
some deep stuff, man. We went through some hurt with the losses, with whatever. And then just like Zim is talking about, and this is for you who are married and have to deal with divorce and deal with some of those things. He's absolute. We got to forgive ourselves. You know, sometimes, you know, the devil will weigh you down with reasons and try to condemn you in areas and make things look like it's your fault. Mm-hmm. You start trying to, and I'm going to tell you, man, a divorce for so many years like that, man, that's just like a loss. Mm-hmm. You know, we had Dr. Rashonda on a couple of weeks ago and she was speaking about it. That stuff is heavy. But these things cast you into a pit of condemnation and things like that. So sometimes you gotta watch it.
Yeah. Hey, it's no secret, you know. I've spoken on this several times. I too was involved in a marriage, and I am divorced. You know, like I said, separation was deemed necessary. And a lot of that has to do with where you are. But as I was speaking to earlier, as far as the main, one of the quickest ways to repair, to fix, to heal, and much, I mean, exactly what your mom was saying, was she turned to God. It's about God. At the end of the day, God's word, right, reigns supreme. Mm-hmm. When you're in those situations, and I spoke to this earlier, you have to look at your self, and it's your relationship with the Lord, it's your relationship with God, guys, that's going to help you navigate through these storms and in whatever form that they come in. We're talking about healing, we're talking about fixing, and I just to expound on what my man just spoke of, marriage, and as you said, particularly lengthier marriages, it does, it feels like a death, man, you know,
like there's something I'm going to ask you about that, though. When you say, you know, turn into God, I'm going to ask you something. I think we got to go on the break.
We got to. Hey, I'll be right back. I'll be right back.
We got time? So, yeah, we got. Well, let me ask you this. So I'm going to ask you this. When you say coming to God, right? So now, mind you, a lot of people who think that they know us, right? There's no time limit that says that when you come to God, that he can't turn you. Because sometimes we do. We fall into a place, whether it be depression, whether it be anger, whether it be, you know, we want to fight. We want to. But the thing is, there's no limit to trying to get it together. And when we come to God, to really subdue us and turn us from that place, or give us, put us in that position where we can get healed, where we can listen better, where we can understand better. You know, what was that like for you? You know, maybe the time length after your marriage or whatever, you know, what was your roller coaster, so to speak, when those things happened that way, when that hurt and stuff transpired?
Okay, because I don't think I ever said I had a roller coaster.
Well, I'm assuming because, you say pain.
No, I got you. I got you again, well, I don't want to. Never mind. It's funny because now everything you say is going to sound petty. I'm not being petty, but things happen the way they were supposed to happen at that state. And I'm not saying God wanted divorce. Not at all. Hey, I didn't get married to get divorced. But at that time, that was the best decision for me. And to answer your question, because for whatever the reason of the divorce, I just want to acknowledge that different people feel different ways. Okay? Every divorce isn't met with depression.
Well, let me say this like this. I just want to say this. Right. You ever hear, like, when you were going through what you're going through, and you tell somebody, oh, I'm going to pray for y'all. No, don't pray for me. Because this is something that has to happen, right? Okay. Have you felt
That's not where I felt, and that's not necessarily my response, because I understand, again, I didn't get married to get divorced. I'm just saying, I don't want it to be believed that everything is dark and gloomy afterwards. Sometimes, you know.
I get that. I like that.
You know, I can. I want to sing a song. But let me stop, dog.
Did you say you want to sing a song? Is that what you're saying?
Yo, I can see clearly now. I'm sorry, man. Stop, man. So we're talking about, here's my thing, and this definitely applies to marriage. And I listened to my brother, who I think says that he has moved on and got his queen, got a second queen. Yeah. Okay,
he's in the game.
He can see clearly, too.
Yeah, he can see clearly. He's seeing real clear.
When I was able to seek that relationship, a stronger relationship with the Lord, and I told friends of mine who I care about deeply, and they were having issues in their relationship, I just told him quite simply, and this was something that was made clear to me, and hopefully it'll help
somebody else.
It's not in my case, it's not my wife who dictates or determines my relationship with him. Mm-hmm. It is my relationship with God. It is my relationship with God, with Jesus, my Lord, my Savior, and how he would have me what he calls me to be as a husband, as a head of house. And it's that love, it's that relationship that I have with him. See, because she'll make me angry. She'll say something to upset me. She'll she'll do something that she knows I don't like, right? Because she too is of the flesh. That'll get me going. So if I focus on her, but if I, in marriage, focus on that cord that keeps us, right? That makes that rope so much harder.
Keep you bind,
To bear. If I keep God first, my focus on God, now that's what's going to keep the marriage where it needs to be. I'm going to honor his instruction, his word, how he would have me to. See, that complaint that she had because I was out drinking, or that perfume that she smelled because I was out doing whatever, or whatever the complaint is, that now that she's upset and I'm now responding to her
emotion,
and then we're going, never happens if I just kept my walk, kept my life, kept my stuff focused.
That's real, man.
How I should.
That's honest.
And vice versa.
That's pure.
She doesn't have to be so consumed with me and what mistakes I'm making, or what she's allowed herself to believe. Focus on how to be the best wife you can. How to be... Am I saying it right?
What you're saying is powerful,
am
man.
I saying
these
it
is
right?
Nuggets. These.
Because that's what... That's what, and some of us try, don't get me wrong. Some of us try and it just doesn't work out. It doesn't mean that your method or ideology, your faith, your religion was wrong.
Yes.
You just had to grow. We just had to mature. I just had to grow. I just had to mature. And if I had done so, there are so many things I could have overlooked, I could have forgiven, or that would have never happened, and vice versa. If my eyes weren't so focused on her, she's human. She's what she was, a born sinner. But if instead, if I kept my eyes on the true prize. What we got here?
I think we got another caller chiming in.
Well.
But I, no, but I'm hearing you. And I'm going to tell you, what you just said and shared with the people right there, man, if they, if y'all didn't hear that, that's pure, that's honesty. That was deep, L. And that was something that you, that, man, they that, You done saved a marriage right there, I promise you.
I hope so.
I promise you.
I hope
you
did.
Okay, call it there. Are you there? Where you are you there? What's your name? Where you calling from? Can you hear us? Caller, what's your name? Where you calling from?
Hold on. Hey, caller, how's it going? What's your name and where you calling from?
Do we got a caller?
Hello, hello. Okay, well. Whatever.
Well, we talk, but like I said,
difficulty that, there.
You saved somebody right there, man, because that was honesty. And let me tell you, I've been divorced myself twice, actually. I married my best friend, and we were married for 12 years. But I have enough wisdom and stuff now to understand it this way. I no longer tell people that I was married young. I tell them I was divorced young, because I divorced without wisdom and... You know, and then I'm going to tell you, man, once I divorced my wife, the floodgates opened on the things that I saw. I did not know in a lot of cases that women were the way that they were. Not saying that I was naive to any approach, but growing up in the faith, growing up in the church, you know, you have we have these rules. You know what I'm saying? And I'm going to tell y'all, this is another reason why I'm here at Church Unplugged today. We had these rules, and it was so religious and so whatever, and my mind was a little warped a little bit, you know, and because I was seeing things in a different way. Oh, you doing this, you doing, and then, you know how you walk out of your house, and I had a beautiful wife and whatnot, but I just didn't have wisdom enough to follow the things that I should have followed. She never cheated. She wasn't that type of person. I just let other issues that we had, like you say, if I'd have stayed focused and maintaining, I let small issues be big to me.
Right.
Because I was a preacher, because I was whatever, we was in the church, we was in the word, and we was, I let that stuff, you know, become an obstacle in my marriage, and I walked away from a marriage, I walked away from a good woman, you know, not saying that, you know, I'm good today, I'm fine, You know, she's fine. She's happily married. We good friends. We raise good kids. We're friends. Things like that. But I'm just being open and transparent about what I didn't see at the time. Yeah. You know, sometimes you think you're right when you're wrong. Mm-hmm. And that was me. That was me and some negativity that got into me, and I let it blow up to something bigger. And I'm just being honest and forthcoming. Hopefully that helps somebody.
Yeah.
But I see today. I mean, that's 20 years ago.
I want to be clear, and even as I'm conscious of what I say,
yeah,
and I'm conscious of the people who hear it, and particularly loved ones. You know, the idea is not to hurt anyone. The idea is not to expose anyone. And so, even in my humor, I do want to acknowledge how, yeah, a relationship, right, a mm-hmm. lengthy one, 19 years married and dated, what, 5-6 years or mm-hmm. whatever before that, you know, almost quarter
you old, of a, playboy.
Almost a quarter of a century.
Yeah.
You know, we met real young. We met real young.
What, when y'all was 6?
But the point I'm trying to make is just going back to that healing.
Mm-hmm.
One aspect of it I dealt with better, but there were others. So I have children.
Yeah.
And as a parent, you really, as a conscious parent, you pay attention to your children and, mm-hmm. and how that impacted them. Now, mine, although in comparison to so many others, were older.
Yeah.
And had gotten a healthy dose, right, of mm-hmm. mom and dad. I don't think it was always, I say a healthy dose. They got mm-hmm. a lot. I don't think it was always the healthiest.
Yeah.
Okay. If we're just going to be honest. But also, I started with my company, and I was going across the country, so I was not there. I was not local anymore. My mm-hmm. job, my career.
Yeah.
And so I'm just thinking of relationships again. Here we go, relationships, and how that impacted not just the two primary parties, the husband and wife,
mm-hmm.
but the children
yeah.
and the relationship. And again, the direction that we're taking on is the Church Unplugged. Scripturally, right? Faith-based instructions,
mm-hmm.
advice
mm-hmm.
to help build and stronger individuals, to help heal
mm-hmm.
is very important. You know, that came to mind mm-hmm. during, excuse me, because I could be selfish and just talk about me,
yeah.
but I am aware of mm-hmm. others. I am aware of my ex.
Mm-hmm.
I am aware of my children
mm-hmm.
and how a decision we made impacted them. So in love,
yeah.
I extend, again, this is what I can offer in terms of how to heal, how to move forward. I can show you what the word it says. So it may not be a marriage
mm-hmm.
necessarily segment,
yep, you're right.
But when we're talking about who to turn to,
yep.
Where's the word? Where's the scripture? Mm-hmm. Where's that power? And there's power in the word, mm-hmm. okay? For those who truly believe, let's just be about directing folks to where, you know, and, not gossip, not a TMZ or a Facebook advertisement, but where the true answer lies.
But here's the true answer right now. If you're in a situation or you're in a relationship, and remember we started out speaking about necessary relationships, mm-hmm. You got to understand what those necessary relationships look like. And even what you just said, when you are divorced or you moved on, you may not have never gotten married, but you had children. You know, you got to respect the necessary relationship that has mm-hmm. to evolve between two parents, you know, when it's come to taking care of those children. And I'm going to say it like it is, man. Don't, and I'm going to speak to marriages or speak to the coming apart of relationships. Don't come apart and lose sight, like you said, of the children involved. Don't come apart if you're a man and you was in love with a woman, but you mad because she moved on. Now you don't want to have anything to do with your kids. Your own. You got to be conscious about that. Be conscious about what you need to do for necessary relationships and vice versa. Don't be a woman mad because, you know, you and a man no longer together and because of which, you know, you ain't going to let him see his kids or you ain't going to come see yours, whatever. And I'm just shooting out there because based on what we're talking about, we know that it's not specifically a relationship segment, but this is Church Unplugged. We're speaking about the things that maybe they're not saying to help you in the pulpit, right? we have an opportunity and a platform to bring some stuff to light. And I'm really glad that you have been transparent enough to speak about your situation, about the vulnerability of that and the openness of it, because that does. That makes a call out to some people that are dealing with this. You know, when you have a necessary relationship, it's time to clean it up. Sometimes you may have to take the stance and like they say, fall on the sword, you know, fall on the sword. You know, sometimes we have to do that, and that's be the hardest thing for us to do. But when we are trying to heal and we're trying to get better, it doesn't matter what your past said that you were. Allow your past to be just a simple blueprint of your learning and where you have to go in the future. Your past shouldn't define everything about you, but you have to respect your past. You got to respect where you came from. You got to respect what you've been through, and you got to look at it enough to learn how to move forward. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. You got to look at it enough to learn, you know, what we need to pray for, what we need to seek God on. We got to look at it enough to know the difference. And don't be that person that puts yourself in a place to where your past, your troubles, your trials, your tribulations have become the center point, and then now God is on the back burner, or the things that are necessary on the back burner, because I'm telling you, you are on a path of destruction if you do that. We have to be strong enough, open enough to come into it, get into our word, get to some a safe space, a mm-hmm. safe circle of people, whether it be your pastors, your the friends, the armor-bearing friends, not the pall-bearing friends, the armor-bearing friends, somebody that can see you for who you are and see your faults just the same. If you really want to heal, if you really want to heal, we have to open up, you know, the problems that we have, not just the problems everybody else do. And I've been a product of that. And I appreciate you talking about that, L, because, like I say, I do think that that's helping somebody right there. So we got a break that's on us right now. We got to pay a few bills. But this is the Church Unplugged. Man, get involved, man. This is healing that we're talking about. We'll see you in just a minute.
Red light, green light, and we might go all the way up.
To the street lights, red light, green light, and we might go all the way up.
To the street lights, red light, green light, and we might go all the way up.
We might go all the way up. paparazzi, then I popped off and started getting buckets. We've been out here making moves in the game. Go tell the squad that we gunning. It's like Jesus was standing on top of a bank. You know it's God over money. We're with the 5,000. Diamonds on me like a fountain. I've been shining so brightly. Look like Austin when he left the mountain. I see people and I've seen God. And only one of their opinions matter. I know the first I'm following the ladder. Elevated like I climbed the ladder. Home run, hey, battle, battle. Stay focused, I don't hear the chatter. You keep on losing, we see in a pattern. You don't want to smoke, we cut me to saddle. Pop, watch how you talk to me, ay, hey, yo. You cannot walk with me, ay, hey, yo. I got my God with me, ay, hey, yo. Nobody's stopping me, ay, hey, yo.
Red light, green light. We don't pay attention to the street lights. Red light, green light. And we might go all the way up.
Hey, welcome back, guys, to Church Unplugged. And today, we've been talking about, you know, how to fix what's been broken, how to heal what's hurting. And it has been relationship-based and irregardless. We're talking about relationships, parent and child, husband and wife, friends, co-workers, and the importance of fixing, healing, the importance of, in some cases, maybe it requires removing, right? You have seasonal relationships, but how do I identify those and still operate accordingly, operate in a manner which is pleasing to our God? And one thing, as I said, it's very much so an individual choice, an individual resolve, and oftentimes I was told growing up, when you have art or when you have a problem with someone, don't pray for them, you know, for them to be changed and for them to be fixed. That, as I've matured, maybe there's another way to approach that, but my focus should not be on the other person or the individual I have a problem with. My prayer should be, Father, you know, where am I wrong? How can I be fixed? What am I doing wrong? You know, how can you soften my heart or show me even now? Because I think I'm right. You know I'm right, God. But, you know, if I'm not, show me. And that oftentimes, in most cases, I can say with myself especially, okay, begins to bring about that change. And anyway, I just want to point that out. And I just want to encourage all of you to remember that you're never alone. All right.
Absolutely.
Those of us who believe and subscribe and live according to you do so with confidence. You do so with that attitude and expectation of the Son of a living God. But we're reminded here in Isaiah 41:10. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And this, again, is just something to help give you strength when you're feeling weak or if you're doubting or if you're wondering or sometimes you feel very much so in a fleshly state. Since in a fleshly state, you feel alone. The words that you've heard, everyone's against you. No one's riding with you. That's no one's speaking up for you on your behalf. Why don't they see what I see, feel what I feel? Why they believe in her? Why they believe in him? Why? We get there, and I know that's very real. Mm-hmm. Stop, pause. Remember, don't focus on them. The focus should be on yourself. What role did I play? How can I become better, Father? Show me, fix me, heal me. Let that be your humble prayer initially and do so with the total confidence he's with you. He hasn't left you. You're tapped into the greatest source that there is,
and
okay?
And he just said that to you.
The greatest. He said that to you. Don't worry. I'm with you.
Yeah.
Focus more on me, and we're going to get this thing taken care of. Trust me. I've done it before. I'll do it again. And anyway, that's powerful. I just know a lot of what we face, quite honestly, if we're just going to keep it real, is a result of who? Our own actions.
Our own actions. And you know what? We it's a lot of self-inflicted wounds that we deal with. And but yeah, as we close that out, like you say, be not dismayed, because I am with you. That's the same thing that Mom said. You know, you got to turn to Christ.
That's
right. Turn to Christ.
That's right.
You know, my brother Elder Zim, when he called in, he that's the same thing that he echoed. He turned to Christ. God is there. He's there. And sometimes we really need to humble ourselves, like you just said, and ask for that strength exchange. And when we can't do it right, He can lead us to do it right. When we ain't going to say it right,
come on,
He'll show us how to say it.
Come on.
And sometimes it's better left unsaid if it's going to be that emotional drag down that a lot of us feel like we have to go through to try to better a situation, to try to elevate ourselves above the situation or above the other person. Mm-hmm. So in light of that, absolutely, the first step to healing is looking at ourselves. Mm-hmm. Looking at ourselves. And taking the Bible says a sober inventory. You know, don't look at yourself when you are high and mighty and riding out, and you know your bank account is right. You're this. You're on the influence of your friends. You're on the influence of whatever else. Look at yourself soberly. It don't always mean from a drunken perspective. On the other side of it, it's a whole bunch of other reasons that we don't see ourselves. Mm-hmm. It's a whole bunch of reasons that we really don't see the realness of what we need to be looking at in order to make a change. So just as you just said, it starts with us. Healing starts right here. Healing starts in the mirror, you know, the man in the mirror. That's where healing begins. And you said it perfect, man. A lot of times we go praying for everybody else. We pray for God to change them. God to change you, change us. Mm. Let's work on the change there. So we are getting ready to close out here. And we do always want to extend an opportunity. If you don't know Christ, you don't have no church home, you don't have a place that you go, hey, we are here for you at the Church Unplugged, but we do encourage you to find you, wherever you at, find you somebody that you can trust, that you can rely on, find you a good church that you can be a part of. We're not here trying to say churches are bad or nothing like that. In fact, we are trying to lighten your burden enough to where when you do go to the church, you can go to the church giving of and not always been into a place to receive. And so therefore you won't have to worry about such the look about it. If we go and we walk into a place and we have the understanding about what we can do when we get there, what can we give? What can we, and this is part of the same healing. What can we do to make it better? What can we do to change things that we don't like? Or how can we implement things that we don't see? So find you a place. And sometime, understand, it might be for you to have come and have made the difference or to make the difference that you're actually looking for. And that's healing. So I'm going to say that. So with that, if you are unsaved, man, and you are hearing this broadcast in any way, shape, or form, whether it be live or replay, Spotify, TuneIn, iHeart, man, I implore you to look to God, accept God as your personal Savior. And it's a starting place. Only qualification that you have to have is to be a whosoever. That's all he asks you to be, is a whosoever. So whosoever will come, whosoever will accept him in their heart, believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and he laid his life down on the cross for our sins, you know, you shall be saved. So we offer you that every show, every week. And with that, we're going to pray for you. We'll pray for us. Oh, by the way, we're going to have Church Unplugged t-shirts are here, y'all. So y'all got to support us. Come on out and get them. $25 for men, $23 for women. We got all sizes pretty much, extra large, large, medium for men and women. I don't think we got a women extra large. You can send your size, send your order. We have the email, thepastor@thechurchunplugged.com. Send your address where we can send it to you at. We have a Cash App, which is the $ Church Unplugged. So you can send your money if that's what you want to do. So please support us. We're here, and I thank God for Lester. We're here together on air. We're trying to bring you something different, trying to support you in a different way. And so we just ask
bring you something that's needed.
Yeah, needed. And we're just asking that you show your support. But with all that being said, dear Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for this opportunity, Lord. We thank you for this platform. Father, we thank you for this radio network. We thank you for every voice that has lifted up their ears to hear us today. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Holy Spirit that's always so willing and inclined to guide us into what we need to say, what we need to do. Father, there's a lot of people that are hurt out there many different ways. So we are asking, Lord, that you send your angels to set with them. Send your angels to give them a particular element of freedom, of peace, of instruction. Allow them to turn and let them know that it's okay. Turn to you. Turn to safe situations, safe circumstances. That, in fact, Lord, we ask that you position circumstances around them, that you set a hedge around them, protect them. Don't let them fall so deep. Don't let them fall so hard into a place that would destroy them. Father, we are praying for everybody that their life be changed. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the testimonies of all of our callers. And we ask, and Father, that you just protect our listeners, those that are out there that are hearing us in any way, shape, or form, even those that don't. Father, we ask that you change or create a paradigm shift of what's happening right now in this world. We need protection. We need peace. So, Father, we stand on this platform. We stand on what you have challenged us and charged us to do. But we ask, Lord, that you reach out and that you heal our land, that you heal our people, that you provide peace in a space where there's so much destruction. But with that we've been said, we ask you in the name of Jesus these blessings. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Amen. Y'all, this is the Church Unplugged. We ask y'all to tune in each week. This is the pastor. This is Lester.
Yep.
Man, we here. So we ain't going nowhere. So come on in and see us. Church Unplugged, 9 to 11. You want to give them the station L?
ATL's Next 100 on IBNX Radio, IBNX Media. Let's see, we're on within 24 hours. You'll see us on YouTube, Spotify.
TuneIn.
Is it on TuneIn?
And iHeart. So and iHeart is a big deal. So we need right. iHeart.
So that's where you can get with it. But again, live is right here on Facebook, 9 to 11 Saturday morning.
Yep.
That's ready. It. We ready?
Yep. Come on, I'm
out.
See us.
I'm out.
We out of here.
Yep. I'm up.
Turn me up, Slim. Turn me up, Slim. Turn me up, Slim. Oh, you say, yo. Hey, turn me up, Slim. Turn me up, Slim. Turn me up, Slim. Oh, you say, yo. Turn me up, Slim. Turn me up, Slim. Turn me up, Slim. Oh, you say, yo. Hey, turn me up, Slim. Turn me up, Slim. Oh, you say, yo. You say, yo. I said, ain't no guy like the one I got. Matter of fact, ain't no other guy, period. Everything you've done for me, they can't be serious. How could I not believe that you will? Till the night, I'ma still get these dreams to pop. And stay a trumpet and sign, that's a word that pops. I'm from the bad boy life, know that I won't stop. Till the Lord come and stop my heart beat. Y'all can't believe the eyes that I beat. A soldier, take off the boots of my feet. God called the play, called the give and go. So I gave my promise to him, now I'm going to sleep like
IBNX Radio.